1940, 1945. These were the years of the Second World War in the Netherlands. How did the Netherlands experience the Second World War? Weren't the Dutch seen as fellow Aryans by the Germans? Did the Dutch perhaps suffered a lighter occupation or not at all? Well, that's what you're gonna find out in this video. In this video, I'm gonna talk about World War II in the Netherlands. Hey, good to have you back. Welcome to this video. And if you're new to the channel, my name is Stefan. I'm a history teacher from the Netherlands. That explains the accent. And I make videos about history for you. And if you like that, please consider subscribing and also hit that notification bell so you'll be notified when a new video comes out. It was May 15, 1940. In the Dutch town of Rijsoord, General Winkelman signed the unconditional Dutch surrender. The Queen, as well as the Dutch government, had escaped, or fled, to England. There, they formed the Dutch government in exile. The city center of Rotterdam laid in ruins. 800 Dutch citizens laid dead. Around 2,000 Dutch soldiers perished in the war violence. Many of them were killed on the Grebbeberg, where ill-equipped Dutch soldiers fought against effective German attackers. The unconditional surrender did not apply for the southern Dutch province of Zeeland, because there were still Allied troops stationed who had to retreat. After they did, Zeeland was also occupied by the Germans. And so, the German invasion of the Netherlands was over and the occupation had begun. Now, initially, the German occupation was light. The Dutch were seen as fellow Aryans by the Germans. As a sign of good gesture, Hitler ordered the release of the Dutch POWs in July 1940. The highest form of authority was the Reichskommissar Arthur Seyss-Inquart. Under Seyss-Inquart served 1,500 German civil servants, and they passed their orders through to the Dutch civil servants who worked for them. Furthermore, German police of the Sicherheitspolizei, as well as German soldiers, were stationed in the Netherlands to maintain order and also near the coast to prevent a possible attack from England. With these policies, the Germans tried to introduce National Socialism to the Dutch, and they did this with propaganda, newspapers, leaflets, as well as the cinema and radio broadcasts. And then there was also the NSB, which was the Dutch National Socialist Party, led by Anton Mussert, which was already existing before the German invasion of the Netherlands. Now, after the German conquest of the Netherlands was completed, the party received an influx of members. Yet, many Dutch weren't willing to join a pro-German party. In February 1941, the February strike occurred, which was organized by the then outlawed Communist Party of the Netherlands. At first, they wanted to strike against forced labor of Dutch industry workers in Germany, which was known as the Arbeitseinsatz. When at that point the occupator halted the transfer of forced laborers, the CPN found another cause: the prosecution of Dutch Jews by the Germans in Amsterdam. This was also where the strike started, and it spread to other cities as well. Around 300,000 Dutch workers participated in the strike. The Germans suppressed the strikes. Other strikes would occur throughout the war. It was clear that the Dutch did not voluntarily make the shift towards the German ideology. So therefore, the Germans used repressive measures and shipped off Dutch workers to Germany. Over 500,000 Dutch workers were put to work in Germany. And those who did not want to do that, they had to hide. And these men were not the only people that had to hide. The most important German measures that were applied in occupied Netherlands were their anti-Jewish policies. Step by step, the Jews were segregated from society. Late 1940, Jewish civil servants had to register themselves, only to be laid off later. In September the following year, Jews were segregated from schools. More and more places were off limits to them. Think of restaurants, cafes, theaters, parks, and public transport. From May 1942, they had to wear the yellow star in public. The following month, they had to register themselves to be transferred to working places in Germany. Many of them were first brought to the transfer camp of Westerbork, and after this they were transferred to various other camps, never to return. Although not of Dutch origin, the most well-known Jewish person was Anne Frank. With her family, she hid in Amsterdam, but they were discovered in 1944 and sent to various concentration camps. Anne would not survive the war. Around 100,000 of the 140,000 Dutch Jews did not survive the Second World War. This is an extraordinary high amount, especially if you compare it with surrounding occupied countries. Why was that? I encourage you to leave a comment down below. In the future, I will dive into this. Most Dutch citizens adapted to German rule as best they could as the war progressed. And as Germany suffered more and more losses, its grip on the Netherlands tightened. Products became scarce because they were all shipped off to Germany. Therefore, a system of ration stamps was introduced for food and other scarce products. These were distributed via various offices, and these distribution offices became often target of the Dutch resistance. So what about the Dutch resistance? Well, there was resistance, both active and passive, and as the German rule became more and more oppressive, resistance activities sprung up. There were different types of resistance. One I mentioned before was going into hiding or take people into hiding. These were Jews as well as people that wanted to avoid forced labor. Resistance members printed and spread anti-German leaflets, maintained radio contact with the Allies in England, approached bankers for finance, helped crash elite airplane pilots, provided fake passports, and committed assassinations of high-ranked collaborators. Examples of resistance members were Hannie Schaft, Gerrit van der Veen, Walraven van Hall, and Erik Hazelhoff Hoefsema. But these are just a few out of many. The resistance movement grew from initially a group of a few hundreds to 25,000 active members. 2,000 of them were executed by the occupier, and an additional 4,000 perished in the camps. But where there was resistance, there was also collaboration. After the war, it was really a black and white vision. So you were a good Dutchman and you were with the resistance, or you were a bad one and you were a collaborator. In reality, it was a gray area. An important example were the city mayors. As a city mayor, what would you do? Would you stay in your post and carry out the German orders and try to avoid as much suffering as possible? Or did you step down in order to make way for an NSB mayor? Statistics show that around 10% of the Dutch people actively collaborated with the Germans. Some became civil servants, others joined the police, others hunted down Jews, and others volunteered for service at the Eastern Front. Around 25,000 Dutch volunteers served in the SS. And after the liberation, these people were prosecuted and often publicly humiliated. But also, girls that had slept with German soldiers, they were shaved bald and called krauthoers, moffenhoeren. But can you consider these girls as collaborators? Well, recent views become more nuanced about this. And this brings us to the liberation. After the D-Day landings on Normandy, France in June 1944, the Allies rapidly advanced to the Benelux countries. In September, they reached the southern border. Because of a miscommunication via Radio Orange, the Dutch thought liberation was at hand. This day became known as Dolle Dinsdag, the 5th of September. Even Germans fled, but soon returned as it appeared the Allies weren't moving in. Then the Dutch government in exile called the Dutch railway workers to strike, which they did. Meanwhile, the Allied advance, which consisted of British, American, Polish, and Canadian troops, got stuck at the main rivers and Operation Market Garden failed. For those who came to live in the new front line, life became unbearable. My grandma, she was one of them. They had to flee. Bullets were flying around their ears. Dead bodies were laying in the grass. Resistance members who saw the end of the war was there intensified their actions. But so was the reaction of the occupier. Many resistance members were often summarily executed. And then there was the tragedy of Hutten, a town that suffered a great ordeal in October 1944. All men were rounded up and shipped off to the concentration camps in Germany as a reprisal for a resistance activity. And most of these men would never return home. The railway strike led to severe food shortages in the north of the Netherlands, and this became known as the Dutch famine, or the hunger winter, or hongerwinter. 15,000 Dutch citizens perished in this famine. Also, the severe cold attributed to death toll. In April 1945, the rest of the country was liberated by the Allies, and on the 5th of May 1945, the Germans signed the unconditional surrender in the city of Wageningen. World War II in the Netherlands was over. Or was it really? Since this is an overview episode, I obviously had to leave out many aspects, and I'm willing to dive into that. So if you feel something is missing out, please leave a comment down below and perhaps I'll make a future episode about that. Yes, you can support me so I can make better, cooler and more awesome content for you. The link is right here. Now, if you think that all Dutch citizens were now free, well, no, because there were Dutch citizens interned by the Japanese. If you want to know more about that, you click right here. If you want to know more about the German invasion of the Netherlands, you can click right here. Thank you so much for watching. Do not forget to subscribe, and bye for now.